Center for Diversity Studies at the Witwatersrand University in South Africa. The title of my presentation is Dangerous Girls and Cheating Boys, Zulu-speaking Disabled Young People's Constructs of Relationships in KwaZulu-Natal, South Africa. The purpose of my presentation will be to just outline the discourses surrounding disabled sexualities and give an outline of Zulu culture, especially in terms of relationships. I then discuss the intersection between disability and relationships, and then outline the research setting for the study under investigation. I then give some idea about the methodology and the type of methodology that I used for this study. Then I want to outline the intertwining violence and love in relationships, the findings from the young people that took part in this study. And then I aim to conclude with just some concluding remarks going forward. For this presentation, I want to make it clear that I situate disability as a discursive construct, and I draw on the United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability, which defines disability as an evolving concept that results from the interaction between persons with impairments and attitudinal environment barriers that hinder their full participation in society on an equal basis with others. So from the outset, when we look at the issue of disability and sexuality, from a start, these concepts are never yet rarely discussed within the same sentence. And given this background, it's no surprise that when it comes to research on sexuality, that young people with disabilities are often excluded. This comes from the fact that they're often constructed as being non-sexual, degendered, and incapable of sexual relationships. And because of this, there's a dominant social cultural discourse that exists around sexuality and disability, and it creates the illusion that people with disabilities are an homogenous group and fails to recognize that individuals are uniquely positioned within intersexual social cultural discourses. And therefore, by doing that, it actually denies young disabled people their sexual agency. So for example, a lot of studies in South Africa that have focused on sexuality and disability have mostly focused on adults and usually focused on the impact of impairment in relation to sexual function. Very little research is actually given attention to relationships and how people with disabilities take place, or how they understand sexual relationships. And because of that, we also are not aware of the social cultural discourses that may impact on the sexual identity of young people, and how issues of culture and gender may influence their understanding of their role in sexual relationships. So in summary, that there is a definite need to include young disabled people in South Africa in sexuality research. The need to include young disabled people is imperative, especially within the South African context, where there's a growing body of evidence to suggest that the rates of HIV infection and sexual violence amongst disabled people are significantly higher than their non-disabled peers. Likewise, young disabled people are found to be at more risk of intimate partner violence than their non-disabled peers. So given this silence surrounding Zulu-speaking young disabled people's sexuality and how they construct intimate partner relationships, the current study set out to address this gap in knowledge. So to give a bit of background in terms of where the research is set, I just want to give some focus towards Zulu culture and the constructs of relationships within Zulu culture. So first of all, what is culture? According to Rose et al. 2006, culture is a set of technologies for governing habits, morals, and ethics for governing subjects. So in turn, in this regard, governing technologies and cultural practices of Zulu culture, like those of many other African societies, provide a framework by which community members are able to align their behavior, attitudes, and actions concerning gender and intimate relationships within culturally acceptable sexual standards. So, like I mentioned, in Zulu culture, there are very particular demarcated gender roles, and these form essential components of heteronormativity and hegemonic masculinity, and they actually uphold a patriarchal violent society, where, for example, women are meant to be seen as passive and men are seen as being sexually dominant. And this has created what we call a violent patriarchal society. But as argued by most scholars, the thing that we don't want to do is not to essentialize aspects of Zulu culture. We need to acknowledge that just like culture, sexuality and issues of disability are not static and constantly evolving and changing. Cultural discourses of relationships are always subject to change. Although scholars have criticized the essentialist construct of hegemonic masculinity and the notion of patriarchy, we need to recognize that patriarchy still continues to remain a dominant force in relationships in South Africa, with violence against women reaching epidemic proportions. So in terms of where the actual study was set, it was actually set in the Yongkongdorvo district of KwaZulu-Natal, which is on the east coast of South Africa. The population of the area itself, there is over 1 million people who live in the district, where 42.7% of that number are between the ages of 15 and 24 years. The other thing to notice about the district is that it is characterized by one of the highest rates of HIV in the country. Although there are no available statistics for the number of young disabled people in the district, recent prevalence data estimate that approximately 8.4% of the population in KwaZulu-Natal may be classified as having a disability, compared to the national prevalence rate of 7.5%. So in relation to the methodology that was undertaken, the study used a qualitative participatory research design and was very much based on a post-structural framework. And by doing so, the study recognized the fluidity of identity and power, and also recognized disabled young people as social agents who are capable of creating and adapting their social world. As a result of this framework, the study adopted a unique position by training disabled young people as co-researchers, which is a method that is rarely applied in sexuality research in the developing world context. So in terms of the sample, there was a purposive sample of 22 young people between the ages of 15 to 24 years old. They were all Zulu-speaking young people with physical and visual impairments who were living in rural areas of the Ungonglovo district in KZN. Like I mentioned, three of the participants were trained as co-researchers. Two of these were female, aged between 17 and 20 years, and one was male, who was aged 15 years. These young people took a very active role. So to avoid the tokenistic use of young people in research, the co-researchers played an active role in developing research questions, the focus group schedules, and data collection and analysis. Because of their involvement in the study, the co-researchers have since co-authored a peer-reviewed article concerning their experiences in undertaking sexuality research with their peers. So in terms of the data collection process, the young people, the co-researchers, carried out four single-sex focus group discussions with their peers and one mixed-sex focus group discussions. The mixed-sex focus group discussion were made up from participants from the four single-sex focus groups. Then the co-researchers chose four individual people that they wanted to interview on an individual basis. As part of the methods that were used, the young co-researchers also kept reflective taped journals to record their experiences during the actual research process. Data analysis was done using a multi-level process using both content and discourse analysis. And during the data analysis process, the co-researchers took an active role in identifying themes and conversations that they also felt were particularly important that arose during the actual data collection process. So, although the original study set out to identify how Zulu-speaking disabled young people construct their sexual identities, the findings presented in this presentation focus on their perceptions of heterosexual relationships. Just to make a point that all of the participants identified as being straight. From the conversations, participants did not perceive their experiences of relationships to be any different to their non-disabled peers and continued to emphasize cultural norms surrounding gender roles in relationships. During the data collection, it was clear that participants had experiences of mixed ability relationships. So, for example, some of the young people were dating non-disabled partners, and likewise, some were also dating those that were disabled. So, in their eyes, they saw their experiences as being no different to their non-disabled peers. So, in terms of the findings, what really stood out was this notion of dangerous girls. So, for example, many of the male participants constructed girls as being dangerous and the cause of spreading HIV. So, as from the quotations from the research, one of the young participants, who is only 18 years old, states that the girls, they take a lot of drugs and they go on drinking sprees. The next thing, a girl sleeps around and you start dating her. If you don't protect yourself, you will get HIV. Another participant stated that, you know, nowadays many girls don't behave well. The boys don't even know where the girl has been, and this may lead to your death. So from these quotations, it is clear that the boys clearly situate the girls as being responsible for spreading the HIV. What is very also clear is that male participants' silence surrounding their possible role in HIV transmission and their desire to distance themselves from dangerous girls is a powerful form of discourse which constructs young disabled men as innocent, disciplined, and having no active involvement in the spread of HIV. However, in contrast to this, I would argue that not accepting their role in transmitting HIV actually increases the young disabled men's vulnerability to HIV infection. So, in relation to the girls' understanding of boys, what came out very clear is that although girls have a very strong idea towards romantic love and choosing a partner or a boy that was respectable, etc., they were actually willing to disregard their ideas around love and accept a boy that cheats. So, for example, female participants presented the notion of cheating boys as a natural and accepted phenomenon. So, although they had their ideals of what their partner was like, they also accepted the fact that boys were naturally born to cheat on them. So, for example, in a conversation between a co-researcher and one of the young female participants, when the co-researcher asked the participant, "What would you do if your boyfriend was to cheat?" the young participant said, "I won't care. This girl and I will share him. He will love her in his way, and I will love him in my way. I will do nothing about it. What is important is that when you are with your man, you spend time together and share different things at the same time. But if he was to cheat on me, I don't care, because what he does with the other girl is their business. And this was a young girl of 19 years old with a visual impairment. Besides accepting the notion of a cheating partner, most female participants also normalized the notion of intimate partner violence, and they saw it as an acceptable component of a relationship. But this was only seen as being acceptable if the violence was used against them to discipline them. So for example, again, when the co-researcher asked a participant if they would be willing to accept a part boyfriend that was physically abusive to them, the participant replied that they would persevere if he was hitting me for the right reasons. He would have decided that the best way to discipline me is to hit me, so it's fine. But if he hits me for no apparent reason, then we will see. So it was very clear from this quotation and many more from the female participants that they normalized the notion of intimate partner violence in relationships. And when probing further into this acceptance of intimate partner violence, one of the female co-researchers reported not being surprised by these conversations, especially given the commonly held belief in many Zulu cultures that if a man loves a woman, then he would hit her. However, if he doesn't hit you, he doesn't love you. So in contrast to the female participants, what was interesting is that none of the young participants spoke about the notion of intimate partner violence. Only one of the participants said that if there was violence in a if there was a relationship that wasn't working, they would rather leave the relationship instead of resorting to violence. But yet again, what is interesting is that the young men remained very silent about the topic of cheating partners. So in conclusion, what is very clear is that although participants downplay their disability in the context of relationship, this in itself is a powerful form of discourse and could be influenced by the negative cultural constructs of disability and disabled sexualities. So therefore, by accentuating other aspects of their identity, such as gender and culture, participants could be depicted as overcompensating for their impairments in an attempt to be accepted as sexual beings in their communities. This in itself perpetuates notions of vulnerability and the risk of intimate partner violence. What is also very clear from the findings is that cultural constructs of gender roles and practices appear to have a more influential position than a disability identity in determining participants' subjective views around relationships. By overemphasizing their acceptance of infidelity and intimate partner violence, the female participants are also reenacting or continue to reenact hegemonic masculinities and patriarchal systems in relationships amongst young disabled people. So coinciding with Jukes and Morel, the female participants' acceptance of male control is largely influenced by cultural discourses which give meaning to their identity. Essentially, notions of cheating and violence become naturalized and internalized position, and as a result, the young disabled women become agents in their own oppression. So based on these findings, what can we recommend going forward for the future? So addressing the sexuality needs of young disabled people can only begin once adults consciously acknowledge disabled young people as sexual agents, and the fact that young disabled people are also impacted by their cultural existence and cultural discourses that surround them. So in that sense, this research strongly calls for a comprehensive sexuality education efforts in South Africa that critically engage with the intersectional discourses surrounding race, class, gender, and culture when addressing issues surrounding young people with disabilities' role in relationships. This research also acknowledges that young people with disabilities are socially able to make impact in their communities. So therefore, it calls to equip young disabled people with knowledge and skills surrounding what makes safer and healthier relationships. And I also believe that this research calls for further research into the sexual behavior and experiences of young disabled young people, and especially in terms of how they understand themselves in intimate relationships. Thank you.